We're on part number 26, now officially the longest series that I've ever taught of understanding the kingdom, and we have finally arrived to the New Testament. And it's been kind of a journey, but there's actually so much more I could have enfolded into the Old Testament out of it that runs along with the kingdom. Now, a little bit of background, we ended in part 25 in the book of Malachi, that God had to judge both the Levitical order because they were teaching people what they wanted to hear instead of what they needed to hear. And I mean, a lot of that's going on today. At the same time, you had the Kohanim that had took the feasts of the Lord and all the service, and they, in their hearts, disdained it and made it where it was detestable both to God and to the people. And because of what happened there with God judging the Levites, we had the epitaph there that began the rabbinical movement. Because when we get to the New Testament time, we have rabbis that are not Levites that are teaching the word. Now, we have to throw into this that during the intertestamental period, we had the invasion of Antiochus Epiphanes and all the horrors that he had done to the Jewish people. And in fact, understanding some of the dynamics of what we see in the book of Acts and with the Jewish people, you have to understand Antiochus Epiphanes. There were two things that he tried to Hellenize them, and he made illegal by the penalty of death. If you did not eat pork, you were killed. If you circumcised your children, they were killed. In fact, one of the stories that really caused the Maccabees to raise up and to begin to be zealous for Torah and zealous for the faith was a story of one woman that when Antiochus came and they refused to eat pork, he cooked them alive one by one. And so, you know, when you get to the book of Acts, we can see the whole debate over circumcision because of the zeal that was caused by Antiochus Epiphanes. But just as a side note, what is not a part of the debate where all these pork-eating Gentiles coming into the church, that didn't exist because they weren't. Because that would have been a part of, you know, if you had an oppressor come and do the horrors that he did, I mean, that two things, you circumcise your kids and you never, never eat pork if you're going to be a good Israelite. And that was still foremost in the people's minds. But what I find interesting, you know, God raises up the Maccabees. They are zealous for God. They are zealous for the covenant. But give them a couple of hundred years. You see, that's what the mystery religions always rely upon. Just give those that are on fire for God enough time and we can get them settled down and put to sleep. And right now, there's more Christians asleep than ever before. Now, they're beginning to wake up. At the conference I just got back to, there were 1,000 people that were awake and that were hungry and for God's Word. It really blessed me and it amazed me. And I also found out personally the two most dangerous things. The most dangerous thing that can happen to me is to be seated between Joe Horn and Josh Peck. There were a couple of times they were thought they were going to have to calm us down just a little bit. But I mean, know that you can have fun and walk with God. Had a blast down there. But they try to put them asleep, and there's more believers asleep today. And one of the things that I hear from those that are awake is how aggravating it is to try to talk to a sleeping believer. And there's that propensity there because even the Apostle Paul in the book of Romans, okay, I mean, the gospel is just getting out to the Gentiles, the churches begin to thrive, and he has to tell the early church to awake out of slumber. Because the mystery religions try so hard to enact spiritual entropy to begin cooling the fire of the Holy Spirit in the lives of believers. And we see that with the Maccabees. Those that started out in such zeal for God ended up being the Sadducees of Jesus' day. That they were more interested in political power than they were theological correctness. And in fact, one of the reasons the Essenes had pretty well went out to the desert was because the Sadducees basically controlled the power of who became the high priest, and they installed a non-Cohen. Direct violation because of political power. And so when Almighty God begins to move after this 400 years, if you will, of science, because even though there was a zeal for Torah with the Maccabees, there was not a prophetic voice. So you go from Malachi, there's this 400-year stretch, twice the age of America, of not having a prophet, not hearing, thus saith the Lord. And then this wild man comes out of the desert, named John the Baptist, and he was eating locusts and wild honey, and by the way, that locust is not the kind that flies, but it's the kind that grows on a bush. I just thought, throw that out there. Literally wearing the mantle of Elijah, because the Essenes were the ones that ended up holding or being the keeper of the mantle that was from Elijah. I remember being at a conference, and one of the world experts on the Dead Sea Scrolls sat there and said, "You want to hear something neat about John the Baptist? It was camel's hair, and Elijah was the only one who could get away with that because camel was not kosher, but his mantle was of camel's hair, and so was John the Baptist." They believed that when he and his mother fled to the desert when they were seeking to kill him and killed Zechariah between the porch and the altar, he went among the Essenes and he was raised there, and they knew his calling, and so they gave him the mantle of Elijah, literally, that he was wearing when he began to preach out in the desert. And what did John the Baptist, coming to the people of God, say? We find this in Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. "In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." He was preaching repentance and to mikvah. And sometimes we don't understand that mikvah is a declaration that not only you're getting ready to meet God, but you've been called by God. When the children of Israel were freed from Egypt and they gathered around Mount Sinai, God says, "I want you to baptize. I want you to mikvah everything. You, your clothes for 3 days," which is a type and shadow of Jesus being in the earth for 3 days before he rose again. And now and mikvah is not something that was strange to the Jewish people. In fact, if you go on the Temple Mount had over 1,000 mikvah pools round about it, because whenever you would go up to the temple for a feast, you would mikvah before you met with God at the temple. But he added something to it, repentance. And one of the things that we're going to see, that was the primary of his purpose of ministry. He was preparing the way for Messiah by being the front guy, or the warm-up band, if you will, crying out the need for repentance. Now, we then go to Jesus in Matthew 4 and 17, and so does Jesus come preaching something else. Now listen to the words here. "From that time Jesus began to preach and to say," in other words, this was his main message. The main message of Messiah was to repent. So, and I'll finish it, okay, "for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." But I want to center in first on repentance, because one of the problems that we have today, guys, is we have a repentless gospel. Not only are they saying that the gospel is repentless, but that you're committing a sin after becoming a believer if you repent, because there's grace. It's amazing to me. And what it has produced, if you cannot enter into the kingdom, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Any true moving of God, historically, since the time of Jesus, was always preceded by repentance. There is no exception, because Jesus established the template that it is impossible to come into the kingdom without repentance. And so now they're saying that we can simply, because what we have is we have this little emotion. The preacher touches us emotionally, causes a little tear, causes some desire, and we have this pseudo-salvation going on at altars. Because there's no repentance, there's no getting right with God, there's no realization of sin. The seeker-friendly model is destroying the body of Christ. Because we better be Holy Spirit seeker. We better be the kingdom of God seeking. We better realize that all of us are wrong and He is absolutely right. And it is by repentance that we enter into the kingdom. What it has produced, guys, because not only of entering into the kingdom, the sanctification process is layers of repentance and coming into more things in Christ. So if you do not have repentance woven into your Christian experience systematically, you never experience progressive sanctification. So what do we have? We have churches that are filled with baptized sinners seeking a carnally perverted religion that denies the power of God and the need for personal holiness. A good portion of my time is spent trying to get Christians saved. Because if they were saved, they would think differently, they would act differently, and they would feel differently about sin. And for those that accidentally get saved in the modern evangelical church, that it regulates them to a life of carnally minded, easy believism, and perpetual spiritual immaturity, because we make everything about salvation and not coming on in, getting saved, and then going on to the things of the kingdom of God. The minute you try to say that we have a responsibility before God, they turn it into a salvific issue when it has never been a salvific issue in the Old Testament or in the New Testament. We need to get saved so that we can go on past the gate of salvation. Now Jesus, in revealing the ministry of the Holy Spirit, in John 16 and 8 says, "And when He is come, He will reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment." That is the main ministry of the Holy Spirit. And let me tell you something, believers, He's come for more than making you speak in tongues. If you're speaking in tongues and you have no concept of sin, or when you do sin, you have no consciousness of it, you don't understand what righteousness is or the coming judgment, the Holy Spirit's not working in your life. Now some will try to say, "Now wait a minute, Mike. The English Bible says world. I'm no longer of the world because I got saved." Well, Jesus had one up on you, because He did not mean of the world. He literally uses the Greek word cosmos. He is to convict the universe of sin. Let's take the, when the gospel is truly being preached and the Holy Spirit is truly moving, what pushes back demonic forces, what pulls the working of principalities and powers, is when the Holy Spirit can begin moving in lives of believers, and it begins to even convict the principalities and powers. The immortals that fell begin to feel the pressure of the kingdom resisting what they're doing. Oh, I like that. Because even though as when we get saved, we no longer have a sin consciousness and that I am birthed of sin because now I've been born again. But after that, I have a greater understanding of what sin is, and I try to avoid it at all costs. And of righteousness. What's righteousness? People can't even tell you what righteous works are because we have been disenfranchised from the Torah. That's where the definitions are. God loved us enough to say, "This is sin. This is what you do when you're doing righteous things." And of judgment. How many know that every believer is going to be judged? Not for sin, but for what they did after they got saved. Now, for a lot of Christians, after they pick themselves up out of the floor, they say, "Say what? You never come before the Lord empty-handed." That one day it's called the believer's judgment seat of Christ. It's not whether you get in or not, but it's what you allowed Him to do through you and in you. is more than just getting saved and parking your blessed assurance on some pew somewhere and just holding out until the end. You're supposed to grow and move and do things for the kingdom. Let me make sure I don't turn off the camera here. Now the difference between Matthew and Mark, because Matthew says the kingdom of heaven, Mark says the kingdom of God. And I've heard all these explanations on why he said that. It's something, you know, it's because of the Greeks, they confuse things, so Matthew said this. And that we go through a lot of gyrations that I have found those explanations were not historically plausible. As a writer, one of the things that I have discovered is when you write, you have those that you're writing to in mind. We know that Matthew, he brings up more than any other Gospels the things that Jesus fulfilled as far as the Old Testament, and that here's all the things that were said of Messiah over and over and over again because he was writing to the Jewish people. Mark is written to the Romans. Luke is written to the faithful. John is written to everybody. And in his day, within the Jewish mind, they had confused the nation of Israel with the kingdom of God. To them, it became synonymous. And so Matthew, when he understood what the message that Jesus came to bring, he had to separate it from the nation of Israel. And so it's the kingdom of heaven. It's up there coming down here. But what's interesting is even at the end of Jesus' ministry, before he ascended, they still hadn't got it yet. It was only after the Holy Spirit came in power that they began to understand what he was doing, because they turned to him and said, "All right, now are you going to restore the kingdom? You're going to go ahead and restore the nation of Israel in all of its glory." They still didn't get it. And he says, here's how the kingdom is going to work. You're going to go into all the world and preach the gospel so that I can bring those into the kingdom. Now, originally, when you see the division, Tower of Babel, man was divided into 72 nations that match with the B'nai Elohim that I think fell at the Tower of Babel, the principalities and powers that were a part of God's divine counsel that fell. And so out of that, there was one. God says, you know what? I'm going to reach into Babylon. I'm going to pull out one guy, and I'm going to make him into a nation that represented me. So it was 72-1. And those that followed the covenant of Abraham, there were those that were citizens of Israel that pressed on into God, that touched the kingdom. How many know Abraham touched the kingdom? Jacob touched the kingdom. Isaac touched the kingdom. Samuel touched the kingdom. David touched the kingdom. Josiah touched the kingdom. There were those because Israel brought you near the kingdom so that you could step on in if you really pressed on into the covenant. Now, with that in mind, Jesus was announcing, I'm getting ready to bring something that's going to allow all of Israel that will yield to step into the kingdom. Something higher. Now, listen to this. This is taken from the Apostle Paul out of Ephesians chapter 2. Starting with verse 11. Now, he's dealing with the Gentiles that were not a part of the kingdom. They were without hope. They were of those 72 nations that were divided at the Tower of Babel that were still a part of Nimrod's war against God. Now listen to his words. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are also called uncircumcision by that which is called circumcision of the flesh made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. That's where we were before we got saved. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes were afar off. Listen, you were afar off. You were out here being a Gentile. You had no covenant. You had no hope with God. Are now being brought near by the blood of Christ. Then we can jump on over just a few verses. We'll pick up with verse 14. Let's just keep reading. For he is our peace who hath made us both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. And he was literally talking about a physical wall in the temple that Gentiles were not allowed to go across. It was a wall of division that had a sign on it, if you go past here, Gentile, you will die. Look it up, it is a historical wall. That Gentiles could, even though you were a God-fearing Gentile, if you did not become physically Jewish, you could not pass it beyond that into the presence of God. So Jesus broke that down. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, and it's not talking about the Torah, but by the separation. There were ordinances in place, and ordinances are only a specific part of the Torah that deal with the sacrificial system and keeping unclean things out of the temple. That's why he used ordinance there instead of law, because it talked about a specific one. It's like the difference in America talking about the Constitution and regulations. Okay, completely different. For to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile unto God both in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity therein. Well, what was truly the enmity? Sin! Iniquity! Not God's law. Jesus said it's eternal. Now listen what it says he came to do. And came and preached peace to you who were afar off, and to them that were nigh. Afar off were the Gentiles, near were the Israelites, the Jewish people. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers or foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and the household of God. So when we got saved, we became citizens of Israel. We were grafted in. We didn't replace Israel. We were grafted into Israel. But then now that we're near, we had to go from being afar to near, because only those that were near could enter into the kingdom. Am I making sense? We had to be grafted in so that we had access. Because the other 72 nations that are steeped in Babylon are not allowed. Things we see here, those that were afar off were made near, they were made citizens of Israel. And all those that were near were called to repentance. Uh-oh. Where did Jesus go? Where did Jesus preach to citizens of Israel? He preached repentance to them. So by repentance, I come from afar to near. And then through repentance, I go from near to kingdom. Okay? That's why the devil hates the preaching of repentance. God's grace does not free us from the obligation of repentance. God's grace gives us the ability to repent with a depth that brings us into the kingdom. I'm about to get happy. And only the new man in Messiah has access to the kingdom. That's why in the book of Hebrews, it was talking about that which was simply available by Moses before the coming, the drawing near. You're going to get this in a minute. Before the cross, you could be near and step in and out of the kingdom and touch the kingdom. after the cross, you can be near, but until you surrender to Messiah, you cannot enter the kingdom. That's why that other system is passing away. The book of Hebrews is quickly passing away. Because you cannot have access to the kingdom except through Messiah. Now, contrary to popular theology today, Jesus was not lowering the standard. He actually raised it to new heights. Because that's the opposite of everything that's being preached today. Let's look at what the new birth was supposed to do in Jeremiah 31 and 33. You need to, and this one, you need to have it marked in your Bible, because it's out of this prophecy of Jeremiah in 31 that we find the concept of the Brit Hadashah, which is translated in English, the New Testament. So when the early church was looking at what Jesus did that we call it the New Testament, it is drawn out of this prophecy. Therefore, you cannot, what Jeremiah is getting ready to say, you cannot disenfranchise it from the New Testament. It's the very epicenter of the concept of the New Testament. It's like saying with peanut butter and jelly, you can no longer have peanut butter, it's just all jelly. You can't have that. It's that quintessential. And this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. Listen, the house of Israel. So for us to have access to it, we had to come into the house. Okay? After those days, saith the Lord, I'm going to do away with grace, or I'm going to do away with the law and just give them grace and they can do what they want and get saved. Is that what it says here? No, it doesn't. Don't you like that the Mandela effect supposedly has not changed these verses? Mandela effect's not real, by the way. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. So the very definition of the Brit Hadashah or the New Covenant is that which Messiah brought, it's no longer just in a book, it's no longer just in a scroll, it's no longer just words written on tablets. The moment that I got saved, the Holy Spirit came and wrote Genesis through Deuteronomy in my heart. Now, why would he do away with that which was a prophetic promise that he would write? You don't write something on somebody's heart and then do away with it. You see, we've let Babylon redefine the Word of God for us instead of letting it speak for itself. Now, so this was the prophecy of Jeremiah. Gentiles, those that would come in this new birth, would have the Torah written on their hearts. Or other words, they would have a new nature that was in line with the commandments of God. Okay. Now, in Romans chapter 2. Now, Paul, I love what the Apostle Paul does, because in the book of Romans, he has haughty rabbis not understanding what's going on, and then he has prideful Romans. He stands them all up in one row and starts at one end and begins to slap them and slaps them all the way down to the other end. He corrects everybody. I like the Apostle Paul. And he's dealing with, he said, now listen, you're pointing at them saying these old nasty Gentiles, they don't know the law, they're not keeping the law, how can we even tolerate them around us? We were given the law. And he begins dealing with them, yeah, you know it, but you don't do it. Okay. And then he brings this up. He says, for there is no respect of persons with God, for as many that has sinned without the law shall also perish without the law. That means the Gentile that died without Christ perishes, and the Jew that rebelled against the Torah of God perishes. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So you can die without it. You can die with it. And as many that have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are justified before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, they've not yet learned Moses, like the Jerusalem Council said in Acts chapter 15, go learn Moses. They've not learned him. These, having not the law, are a law unto themselves, or do by nature the things contained in the law. How could they do by nature things that are contained in the law? Because when they got saved, they got a new nature, and the new man wants to walk according to the commandments of God. They want to honor God. And so the old nature, the old man, wants to rebel against the rulership of God. The new nature, we want to walk with God and do those things that are pleasing in His sight. Having not the law, are a law unto themselves. Why? Because of this new birth experience, they're a law unto themselves. They know, guys, it takes a lot of bad theology to get us off the commandments of God. Oh, that's a series in itself. Which show the work of the law written in their hearts, their consciousness also bearing witness, and their thoughts the means while accusing or else excusing one another. So what he does, this is how Rabbi Paul slaps both the Shammai Pharisees and the Romans, because he later on he says, now you can't point to them and be haughty about it, because God grafted you in. He could snap you off in a heartbeat and grafted you back in real easy. But he says, now listen, you're Jewish like me. You have learned the Torah from birth. You have no excuse. Your head is filled with it, but your heart won't do it, and you're rebelling against it. And now we have the Gentile overhead here. His head is empty. And I think a lot of times we kind of stayed that way, you know. His head is empty. He's never studied the Torah. But now this new heart that he has wants to keep the commandments of God. And so without thinking, he will lean toward them because of this one new man on the inside of him. Guys, it takes a lot of bad theology to bend the born-again man's heart away from the commandments of God. And we have it because we have made everything a salvific issue. The only thing in the entire New Testament that was a salvific issue was the preaching of salvation through circumcision. That's it. To add any more, you have stepped outside of what the Scripture teaches. And much of it is kind of embedded into our Protestantism. And it wasn't protesting the Jews, it was protesting the Roman Catholic Church that replaced God's laws with all their own. Now the Holy Spirit now lives on the inside of us. Now I want you to see this, John chapter 14. Because Jesus connects love for God, the keeping of the commandments, and the Holy Spirit moving on the inside of our hearts. It's all manifestations of the same thing. Starting in verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Now what the devil has had to do is we have had to, in our theology, make Jesus a different God that came and gave different commandments. That is not represented in the New Testament. He is Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. He is Yahweh come in the flesh. He's the one who told Moses, pick up your pen. I got five books I want you to write. Even the rabbis know the Son of Man in Daniel is the only knowable aspect of God. The only knowable aspect. Moses dealt with Jesus. Abram dealt with Jesus. The Father, the Ancient of Days, is that unknowable aspect of God. And Jesus says, nobody can get there except through me. Oh, come on. Jesus is the one who came down in the garden and said, I'll fix this. Okay. And he said, I will pray the Father and he will send you another comforter, a paraclete, paracletos. that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwelleth with you. Now he's saying this to Jewish people that knew that the Holy Spirit could only come and visit the king, the prophet, the king, and the priest. But Jesus is an anomaly. He is the anointed one. And the minute they became his disciple, they began to live around the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit was on him without measure. And so they started getting used to the Holy Spirit always being around them. He said, right now he's with you, but when I go up, he's going in. Oh, if we could only get that. The change in the economy of God, 4,000 years of the Holy Spirit only being able to visit, and it took the cross to get him to where he could come in. Oh, I'm getting happy. It says, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me. Because I live, ye shall live also. At that day, ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them is he that loveth me. So we have our definition of loving God. Oh, I come to church and I cry. I get my hanky out and I wave my hand when during the praise and worship. And many times praise and worship can be very fleshly. Jesus basically is telling them this, and this is a universal concept that goes from Genesis to Revelation. You show me how you love me after you leave church. If you keep my commandments when nobody's looking. If you keep my commandments when the devil puts pressure on you to compromise, I look at that and say, that kid loves me. Been that way since the beginning. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. You want to find out how to get Jesus to manifest himself to you? Start looking for the power of the Holy Spirit to start keeping the commandments, and Jesus will begin manifesting his will and his power and his provision and his purpose to you in your life. I just wish the Lord would manifest himself to me. He cannot manifest in the middle of your disobedience. You would end up being one crispy critter. The only thing the Holy Spirit can do is convict you of sin, and your theology won't let him do it. Yeah. Ouch. Let's go to Matthew chapter 24, verses 4 through 14. I'm going to read this real quick because it is hot in here this time of year. The air conditioner does not work good here. And I can feel the temperature rising, and not just the power of the Holy Spirit, if you know what I'm talking about. Yeah. We need an air conditioning company to sponsor our services and put something bigger in this place. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of war. See that ye are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. And nation shall rise up against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famine and pestilence and earthquakes in divers places. And all these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall arise, and shall deceive many. And because the iniquity of force shall abound, love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the forgiveness of sin. Is that what it says in your Bible? The gospel is, there is one component of the gospel, salvation from sin, the sin nature. And we've even forgot what that is. But it's the gospel of the kingdom. shall be preached. Do you know why I know it's not the end yet and we have more time? Because we have had a gospel go forth, but we have not had the gospel of the kingdom go forth. We have had a watered down version that now is so weak it won't even take out the stains of sin anymore. People are trying out. We're no longer, because I watch what's being preached today, we're no longer saved from sin. We're saved from Moses. Jesus came to save us from Moses. Were you a Gentile? Yeah. You weren't even bothered that Torah didn't include you. That's like saying that right now I'm looking for somebody to free me of Chinese law. Biblical illiteracy has run amok. We take one snippet out of what the Apostle Paul says, take it out of context and make a doctrine around it. Well, the whole time, Peter's looking at everybody's listening to Paul and says, you know what? There are a bunch of people untrained in Torah that don't have a clue what he's talking about. And they're digging their own hole. It's the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations, the rulership of Jesus, that I've been transformed on the inside. I have been brought, I was brought near, and then I went up, and now I'm a part of the kingdom, and I understand covenant. And if you ever get a believer to understand covenant, they're never the same again. Woo! Then the end shall come. That's how I know we have more time. Because the Americanized gospel is not the gospel of the kingdom. The higher reality of the kingdom is that the new birth, the new man in Christ, has had the law of God written on his heart, and the new birth and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit is to empower him to live the commandments under the anointing of Almighty God. That's the gospel of the kingdom. That now we can live it, and that's what is going to provoke the Jew to jealousy, my friends. I've had people get up and say, you know what? We're just going to get rich enough to provoke the Jew to jealousy. Ain't happening. That's called being stuck on stupid, but I tell you what will prick them to their hearts is when a Gentile has a zeal for the commandments of God and are keeping them in a way that is only accessible through Messiah that he can't do. It'll prick him to his heart. It's time to make them jealous so they want Messiah, because you can't get to the kingdom without Jesus. And now we're telling them we have Jesus, but we're not walking in the kingdom. What a moronic thing. This paradox has to be set aside. If I really have Jesus in my heart. I love what my friend Carl Koch, when he was trying to do some things over in Israel, he got to meet with Ariel Sharon when he was prime minister of Israel. And while a lot of people don't know, the prime minister also handles everything that's religious that goes on in the nation is under his authority. And so Sharon asked him, he said, why are you so concerned about the commandments? And Carl looked him in the eye and says, because a Jew moved on the inside of me. Yeah, I'm a Gentile, but when I got saved, a Jew moved on the inside of me that was extremely Torah observant. His name was Yeshua. And this Jew wants to do what Moses said under the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the new man. Not doing it from the outside, but doing it from the inside by the power of God. Father, give us the grace to repent, to come into the kingdom and let the Holy Spirit write your ways and your commandments on our heart. Because, Father, the anointing and power of God will only flow in line with the law of God and nothing else. And, Father, in this day we need to see the difference between the power of God and the power of the mystery religions. Because there's a great showdown coming. And it's going to require people that are cognizant of the kingdom and all it represents. And Father, give us the grace to enter in and to do it, we ask. In Jesus' name.